I chose the book A Vindication of the Rights of Woman by Mary Wollstonecraft. She was born on April 27th in 1759 in London, England, and died September 10th, 1797. She grew up in poverty as her dad was a farmer, but she still got an education. She worked as a lady's companion and governess. She also started a school for girls. She was an English writer and passionate advocate of education and social equality for women. She was also one of the first major feminists of her time. This book is not your typical story, plot, and end. It's more of Mary Wollstonecraft arguing rights for women, so the characters I'm about to talk to you about are a few of the main people she did not like too much and who she argued against within her writing. The first character we have is Jean Jacques. He was a French philosopher who was famous for his ideas about human civilization and the quote-unquote social contract that binds all people in a society together. He also believed that men and women have different biological destinies, which means that society should treat each gender very differently. Our next character is Dr. Fords. He writes on women's education and how it has harmed women by spreading and establishing common stereotypes about them. Mary Wollstonecraft writes, Dr. Ford's sermons have long made a part of a young woman's library. Nay, girls at school are allowed to read them, but I should instantly dismiss them from my pupils if I wished to strengthen her understanding. In other words, she would never allow her daughters to read his writing because she wants them to develop their own intellect. Our next character is a woman, and this woman is the Baroness de Steele. She's a huge fan of Jean Jacques, and she agrees with pretty much everything he says. She has no interest in women becoming educated because she'd rather have women gain power by seducing men and manipulating them. And for this reason, Mary Wollstonecraft absolutely hates her. And finally, we have Dr. Gregory, who wrote a well-known book about how he would like his daughters to learn traditional feminine manners and not worry themselves too much with book learning. He also tells his daughters to hide their true feelings whenever possible. Then he says, be even cautious in displaying your good sense. It will be thought you assume a superiority over the rest of the company. Now I'm going to read a summary of the book. A Vindication of the Rights of Woman is a book by Mary Wollstonecraft published in 1792. It is about female equality, particularly in the area of education. She dismissed the cultivation of traditional female virtues of submission and service and argued that women could not be good mothers or good housewives if they were not well educated. She claimed that women were expected to spend way too much time in maintaining their appearance and gentle demeanor, sacrificing intelligence for beauty and becoming quote-unquote flower-like playthings for men. The book is divided into 13 chapters in which she addressed topics such as the importance of educating women equally, treating one woman with dignity and providing women with the proper training to be good wives and mothers and intelligent companions for their husbands. Within the book, she states, women spend many of the first years of their lives in acquiring smattering accomplishments. Meanwhile, strength of body and mind are sacrificed to the libertine notions of beauty. Can they govern a family with judgment or take care of their poor babes whom they bring into the world? She argued that women couldn't teach and raise children and run a household if they only focused on their own appearance and minor accomplishments like speaking French, playing the piano, and drawing. Such accomplishments made a woman desirable for a man as an amusement, but not as an equal companion. She has been recognized that for many women of her time, raising a family would be their primary responsibility. But she insisted that a husband and wife whose relationship was founded on reason and equality would parent happier and more well-rounded children than families governed by strict discipline and inequality between parents. To end that, she proposed a system of national education in which boys and girls would be educated together and education would be open to everyone. Now I'm going to talk about the themes. So the first theme I'm going to talk about is woman and femininity. She talks about how society should treat women and that women's minds are just as capable of reason and virtue as men's are. She states that women are less physically strong than men, but that strength isn't really all that important in their modern society. She gives the example of how it's not like we're strangling one another for food or running away from predators that want to eat us. What matters most to her is the quality of a person's mind, and there's no difference between the quality of men and women's mind. The biggest theme within the book focuses on education. There is nothing that she wants more than for women to have the access to the same kind of education as men. She was an extremely educated woman, and she felt that if all women had the opportunities she did, more of them would turn into great and productive members of society. In her mind, all of the women's worst qualities came from the fact that they lack proper education and are taught only to care about superficial things. If women had proper training in math, philosophy, art, and science, then she's confident that they could become every bit as good as men. Throughout the book, we are told that women in their society are only wanted for their attractiveness and appeal to men. Mary Wollstonecraft is trying to change this by talking about how women should get education. But I relate this to Moll because she took advantage of the attractiveness part. Moll traded her looks in for money to make her way in the world. She trapped her husband saying how she was wealthy, and then she married them and claimed that she had no money or that it's quote-unquote elsewhere. Mary Wollstonecraft definitely would not approve of Moll's way of living, but I believe that she is taking advantage in her society where women are often defined by their status as sex objects. In closing, I'm going to read one of Mary Wollstonecraft's quotes on education. "Only that education deserves emphatically to be termed cultivation of the mind, which teaches young people how to begin to think." Thank you very much for listening and have a great day.